You may have heard that you work different muscles in an elbow flexion exercise depending on which position your hand is in. Palm up works the biceps brachii, palm neutral works the brachioradialis, and palm down works the brachialis. But why is this a thing on an anatomical level?
In today's video, we'll look at the anatomy of the elbow so that we can understand how such similar exercises can work entirely different muscles. Hello and welcome. If you're new here, my name is Patrick, and this channel is all about anatomy and physiology. We're going to build on the big bones of the arm. There's the humerus, or upper arm bone, the ulna, which is the medial arm bone running from the hard tip of your elbow to the pinky side of the wrist, and then there's also the radius, which runs from the lateral elbow to the thumb side of the wrist. The humerus looks like a smooth ball and socket at the shoulder, but it's got a bunch of tiny bumps and grooves that allow muscles to stay in place while the shoulder joint is moving around. More obvious are the bumps and grooves at the distal end, which is where the humerus meets the radius and ulna to make the elbow joint. Each of these flared tips are the epicondyles. This is the medial epicondyle, which is where all the forearm flexors originate, and this is the lateral epicondyle, where the forearm extensors originate. This here is called the trochlea, and it creates a smooth surface for the ulna's trochlear notch to glide in. This articulation is how the elbow flexes and extends as a traditional hinge joint. It can only move in one direction. Flexion and extension. That's it. The piece of anatomy that answers the elbow curl question is the radius. At the elbow joint, we find the proximal end of the radius, the concave radial head. It's shaped kind of like a golf tee, and it pivots on the smooth, rounded surface of the anterior humerus called the capitulum, making it one of the few pivot joints in the body. You can palpate it on yourself by starting at the lateral epicondyle and going about an inch down the forearm. Flip your forearm back and forth a couple times, and you'll feel the radial head poke out. That radial head is attached to the ulna by a circular piece of connective tissue called the annular ligament. And the fact that the radius can pivot is what allows us to flip our hands up and down, or supinate and pronate. While it seems like your forearm is flipping entirely around, your ulna isn't moving. Your radius is moving around your ulna. As a result, we have to pay attention to which elbow muscles tug on which bones, because if they connect the upper arm to the radius, then hand position will influence how they contract in elbow flexion. But if the muscle attaches to the ulna, it won't be affected by hand position. So, let's get through them. The deepest of the elbow flexors is the brachialis. It's a squatty muscle that originates on the distal half of the anterior aspect of the humerus, basically from the sleeve down. And that big wide muscle converges into a thick tendon that inserts on the anterior ulna, on a bump called the tuberosity of the ulna. A little bit of the coronoid process too. Because it connects the humerus to the ulna, the brachialis is always contracting during elbow flexion, regardless of hand position. Superficial to that muscle is the biceps brachii. Biceps means two heads, each of which originates up on the shoulder. The long head originates on a little bump just a smidge superior to the glenoid fossa of the shoulder joint. It has a long tendon that wraps around the anterior head of the humerus. Meanwhile, the short head of the biceps originates on that weird-looking projection called the coracoid process of the scapula. And since the bicep crosses the shoulder joint, it's responsible for a little bit of shoulder flexion. Those two heads fuse into this big muscle belly and insert on the radial tuberosity, just distal to the head and neck of the radius. But there's also a thin sheet of connective tissue that stems from that insertion called the bicipital aponeurosis. This thing separates some of the deep muscles from the superficial ones and lies on top of the deeper forearm muscles. And that insertion ends up being important for two reasons. Number one, it's on the radius. So unlike the brachialis, which inserts on the ulna, the biceps mechanics will be influenced by forearm position. And two, that connective tissue can get in the way of bicep function, but we'll come back to that. Finally, we've got the brachioradialis, which originates on the lateral aspect of the distal humerus on the ridge just superior to the lateral condyle, this general area here. The bulk of the muscle belly is found within the proximal half of the forearm, at which point it narrows off into a thick tendon and inserts around the end of the radius. Just like the biceps, the brachioradialis inserts on the radius, so it is affected by forearm position, and actually can supinate or pronate the forearm itself. I mention origins and insertions because they influence a few things, like how much torque the muscle can produce.
I want you to imagine your elbow joint like this barbell setup here. The barbell itself represents your forearm, the place where the barbell meets the wall represents the elbow joint, and that weight on the end represents a weight in hand. Now, you intuitively know that it's going to be easier to lift that weight the farther away we get from the axis. In anatomy, that distance between the axis and the force applied is called the moment arm. For the weight, that's the external moment arm. For the effort that our muscles provide, that's the internal moment arm. The brachialis and the biceps brachii have really short moment arms. They insert pretty close to the axis. Meanwhile, the brachioradialis inserts way farther down, closer to the tip of the radius, so it has a long internal moment arm. That means that the brachioradialis can put forth less force than, say, like the biceps brachii, and still lift the same external weight.
The second reason we need those O's and I's is because different muscles are advantaged or disadvantaged depending on their position. What do I mean by advantaged? In reality, all of these muscles will help each other in each exercise at least a little bit, but different positions can tweak how much they contribute to the overall lift. This is the concept that finally explains how forearm position impacts muscle activation during a bicep curl. When the forearm is fully pronated, the radius is twisted all the way over the ulna. This causes that sheet of tissue, the bicipital aponeurosis, to nudge up against the bicep's main insertion on the radial tuberosity. This puts the bicep brachii at a disadvantage. Since the biceps is handicapped, though, the brachioradialis has to take more of the load, but its fibers still aren't running totally parallel, so it's not in an optimal position either. With those two muscles generating less than ideal torque, the bulk of the load is taken up by the only muscle left, the brachialis. This is why fitness coaches will tell you that the prone curl works the brachialis. But remember, since the brachialis attaches to the ulna, it's unaffected by forearm pronation or supination. It's always contracting during elbow flexion. Now, when the forearm is in a semi-pronated position, the biceps insertion is still at a bit of a disadvantage. But luckily, now we're in a position where the fibers of the brachioradialis are parallel to its origin. So in the hammer curl, the brachioradialis can contribute to flexion more than in the prone position. Finally, when the forearm is fully supinated, now the biceps insertion has a clear pull on the radius and can give its all to elbow flexion. Plus, the bicep is a supinating muscle, so it's pulling in exactly the path that it's built for. Again, the other elbow muscles are still activated, but contracting into supinated forearm elbow flexion is the optimal position for biceps contraction. So the big takeaway from this video is that yes, these different forearm positions can work different muscles, not because we can turn on or off muscles, but because of how they attach to the forearm. If you want to learn more about arm muscles, check out this video I did about palmaris longus, but go easy on me. It was my very first Corporis video ever from back in 2018. Otherwise, thank you to my patrons on Patreon. You can get early access to scripts and videos for as little as $2 a month. Have fun, be good. Thanks for watching.